doubt his tender mercy. Who through life has been my guide, all the way my Savior leads me, and cheers each winding path I tread, and gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. You lead me and keep me from falling. You carry me close to your heart, and surely your goodness and mercy will triumph of his blood. And when my spirit clothed in mortal wings its flight to realms of day, this my song through endless ages, his tender mercy. Who through life has been my
sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You would lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Sing worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
So, as we begin our service, I just want to remind you to turn off or silence any electronic device before the service begins. And as you are getting settled, I just want to invite you to take a moment to just silently meditate and prepare yourselves to enter into the presence of the Lord. So now I invite you to stand as we read our scriptural call to worship, which this week comes from 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 to 3. And as we read, continue to just meditate and focus on scripture. So this is 1 John chapter 3. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we enter into your presence this morning, and we recognize that you are the one who initiates this meeting, who welcomes us, and who wants us to be here, regardless of where we're coming from, what our lives are like. You want us here all the same. And Lord, we give you praise, and we thank you for just all the blessings, and we continue to thank you for your Son, for giving us all our lives for mercy. And we give this time of worship to you. And we pray that it would be pleasing to you, that it would give you glory and honor. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I invite you to sing along as we sing songs of praise and worship.
Our God, sing with me how great.
is our God, and all will see how great, is our God. You thought of us,
and you thought of us before the world began to breathe. You knew our names before we came to be. And you saw the very day we'd fall away from you, and how desperately we need to be redeemed. Lord Jesus, come lead us. We're desperate for your touch. Oh, great and mighty one, with one desire we come, that you would reign, that you would reign in us. We're offering up our lives, a living sacrifice. Search our hearts and purify our lives. We need your perfect love, we need your discipline. When we're lost, unless you guide us with your light. And Lord Jesus, come lead us. God, and I will ever pray. and I will learn to walk in your ways, and step by step you'll lead me, and I will follow you all of my days, and step by step you'll lead me, and I will follow you all of my days.
Amen. You may have a seat.
Good morning, VCBC. Happy Mother's Day. Oh, you're welcome. Only one mother here? No, more than that. I remember when I was in Hong Kong during Father's Day, okay, a few years ago. One day, my wife and I, we were having breakfast in the restaurant of our hotel. The manager was, he came and he was promoting to us the special discount that they were offering for Father's Day dinner. And I asked him why they needed a discount for Father's Day dinner. Wasn't it one of the most busiest days in a year? Believe me, he said, no, you're mistaken. You must be talking about Mother's Day. The Father's Day, we always have to offer discount. Oh, well. Anyway, so today is Mother's Day, and we don't expect this discount anywhere. And I am going to talk about a mother in the Bible, of course, a rather famous mother, and her name is Hannah in the Old Testament. When we talk about the Bible character Hannah, most people would automatically think about prayer. The reason is very simple. It's because most of the narrative about Hannah are in the form of two prayers. One of petition, asking God for a son, and another one is a thanksgiving prayer. We need to focus on prayer when we talk about Hannah. At least we think we need to focus on prayer, because her prayers seem to fit our definition of effective prayer. After all, she asked God for something seemingly impossible, and at the end, she got what she asked for, and she did not seem to have spent a lot of time waiting. Therefore, many considered Hannah a model of praying woman. But if we just take Hannah as a model of praying woman, then we have missed a lot about what message the Bible intends to convey to us with Hannah. And such message is not just about how to pray effectively or how to convince God to answer your prayer. This is our problem in reading the Bible. But we like to excerpt different sections from the Bible and treat them as isolated incidents. Bible, on the other hand, is a grand and continuous narrative. And the narrative of Hannah is of particular importance. The narrative of Hannah is recorded in 1 Samuel chapter 1, which is a period transitioning from the era of tribes to a new era of kingdom. And the story of Hannah serves as the introduction of the rise and fall of the kingdom of Israel and runs through 1 Samuel to 2 Kings, a total of 102 chapters. So it's a rather important introduction in the Bible. Well, we have to ask, in order to introduce the transitioning into this grand kingdom era, why a story of a mother begging God to give her a baby? How does it relate to the overall progress of God's salvation history? Well, if we don't read Hannah's story out of this bigger context, we will likely miss the core message that God wants us to learn about. So, let's read a few verses from this passage. It's a rather long passage, so I just have a few selected verses for you today from 1 Samuel chapter 1. And let's revisit this famous story of a mother who asked God for a child. So let me read to you. 1 Samuel chapter 1. There was a certain man from Ramathaim, a Suphite from the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkanah, son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Suf, and Ephraimite. He had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other Peninnah. Peninnah had children, but Hannah had none. In bitterness of soul, Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord. And she made a vow, saying, O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head. So in the course of time, Hannah conceived and gave birth to a son. She named him Samuel, saying, because I asked the Lord for him. When the man Elkanah went up with all his family to offer the annual sacrifice to the Lord and to fulfill his vow, Hannah did not go. She said to her husband, after the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always. So this is the chapter 1, the essence of chapter 1. After reading it, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for the words that you have preserved so preciously for us. I ask that you grant us a humble heart so that we can learn. We can learn from your salvation history. We can learn your mighty act, using people with flaws to fulfill your will. We just ask that today you will also help us to be inspired by the faithfulness of your servant recorded in 1 Samuel, in Hannah, so that not just our mothers here will be faithful mothers, but all of us will be faithful servants to you. But we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So 1 Samuel chapter 1 kicks off a new era of Israel, known as the Kingdom Era, which spans over 500 years until the southern kingdom, Judah, was destroyed by Babylon. When Israel established a monarchy and began, you know, the rule under a king, we can then observe that God's rule and man's rule are not always in sync. They're not always in line. In fact, there seems to be always tensions between God's sovereignty and human's power. Who's the boss? Who's in control? And at the beginning of this new era, God was telling his people through the story of Hannah that history is actually God's story. Also, we need to remember that immediately before the story of Hannah, it's the tribal era of the judges. In fact, the Hebrew Bible, the book of Judges, is followed by the book of Samuel right after it, not the book of Ruth. Okay, that's our Bible, but not the Hebrew Bible. And we need to know that the book of Judges ends with this sentence. In those days, Israel had no king. Everyone did as he or she saw fit. Everyone did as he or she saw fit. Everyone is his or her own boss. There was no God's rule, but only man's rule. I am the law for myself. So the story of Hannah, when put in the right context, is a story about God's intervention in his people at a time when nobody really cared about God. And this new kingdom era begins with a rather complicated family. A man named Elkanah had two wives. The first wife, Hannah, had no child. The second wife, Peninnah, had a few children. You know, Chinese characters can be very fascinating. One of the words for being angry, for those who know Chinese, you know what it means. It's written as men, women, and men. Of course, in such triangular relationship, it just makes everybody angry, right? But then it came to Japanese. They were even more fascinating. They took the Chinese word and changed it. I mean, that's what happened in the ancient time. Now the Chinese always took something and change it, right? But in the past, the Japanese took this word and changed it to women, men, women, and it means not only being angry, but also in competition. I don't even know how to pronounce that. Anybody knows Japanese here? It means two women compete with each other for the men's affection. You know, neither word represents a desirable situation. And this is especially the one on my left. This is the situation of the family here in 1 Samuel. And very soon, we learn that the main character in this narrative is not the husband, it's not Elkanah, the man and the husband, but Hannah, the wife with no child, on the surface, okay? Hannah's infertility did not seem to create any issue for her because her husband clearly loved her and was in favor of her over Peninnah. I was trying to say Penini. However, Hannah was still not happy. In fact, she constantly felt bitter and depressed. She cried all day, would not eat. To understand why she felt that way, we need to understand what it means to be a woman then in the Near East. In ancient Near East, the honor of a woman was directly tied to her offspring. Without giving a birth to a child, a woman would be perceived as a shame. Nothing can compensate such deficiency. And it's not about whether this is a right view or a wrong view, you know, for a woman. It was what it was. The society was culturally conditioned to see a woman this way. And worse, Hannah's pain did not just come from her low self-esteem, but also from constant bullying by Elkanah's second wife, Peninnah. Peninnah had sons and daughters, good for her, and the scripture said that Peninnah kept provoking her, Hannah, in order to irritate her. She's got nothing better to do. Imagine that someone is constantly hitting your nerve on something that you also see it as your deficiency. You will probably feel as bad as Hannah did. So you see, as a grand introduction of the kingdom era, it was a family filled with conflict, bitter, and disrespect. It's not a demonic kind of family. Still, if this is a family that represented God's people, then such people was not the kind that deserve God's grace, God's presence, and God's favor. It's a dysfunctional family in a sinful community where everyone did as he or she saw fit. But yet, God did not forsake them. That's why it's not the end of Hannah's story. Hannah, in her misery, turned to God. This is significant. Before Hannah, there was a similar woman in a similar situation. That woman was Rachel, Jacob's wife. Well, she had no child. While her husband's other wife, Leah, who happened to be Rachel's sister, had a few sons and daughters. So same as Hannah, Jacob clearly loved Rachel more. In Genesis 30, it said, when Rachel saw that she was not bearing Jacob any children, she became jealous of her sister. So she said to Jacob, give me children or I'll die. I was like, what? You know, it doesn't get any more absurd than that, right? Give me children or I'll die. Jacob was like, am I a joke to you? It has nothing to do with Jacob. Why threaten him? But that's Rachel, not Hannah. Hannah's mind was much clearer. She knew that her husband has nothing to do with her issue. Actually, her husband tried to compensate her issue. So she went directly to the one who is responsible. She went to God. She went to the temple and prayed to God. And that's what she said in her prayer. And she made a vow saying, O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life. And no razor will ever be used on his head. This is an interesting vow, right? No razor ever on his head. As weird as it might seem, this is actually the most noble vow one can make in terms of dedication to God in the Old Testament. This is called the Nazareth vow. And this word has nothing to do with Nazi. Okay? Nazir is the Hebrew word for consecrated, separated. The ban for haircut, although it sounds very weird, it's not as bad as it seems. You know, there are two kinds of Nazirite vow, which are temporary and permanent, respectively. Temporary Nazirite ranges from 30 days to a year, and for temporary Nazirite, no haircut in any form is allowed. But for permanent Nazirite, like Hannah's son here, Samuel, and the judge, Samson, so happened they're all Sam, like, they are allowed to trim the hair, just not shaving it off completely. But my question is, in Hannah's situation is this, can she make such a vow by herself? I mean, you wouldn't want your mom to make a vow for you for your whole life, right? Her son, who was not even conceived yet, did not have a say in this, right? Okay, but forget about the son. Most importantly, in the ancient Near East patriarchal society, does the husband have any say in this? Can the mother make such a vow unilaterally? Well, we are doing child dedication today. I'm sure Vanessa and Winfield, they are watching. But first of all, there is no provision whatsoever concerning haircut. Don't worry. And second, it's more a commitment for child dedication. It's more a commitment made for the parents than for the child. Third, as much as we can, we want both parents to participate and to make this decision together and make this commitment together. But in Hannah's case, her husband, Elkanah, was not even present when she was making such a vow. In the Old Testament, the mother is allowed, though, to make such a vow for her child. However, the husband also had the power to veto it after learning about it. But in Hannah's case, we know the husband loved her and obviously was okay about her vow. So everything afterwards was just between her and Hannah. The husband is okay. And very soon, God graciously and miraculously answered her prayer. Hannah became pregnant and gave birth to a son. Verse 20 here, in chapter 1 says, she named him Samuel, saying, because I asked the Lord for him. In fact, the name Samuel means listen by God. The last two alphabet, E-L, L is God, right? So it's listen by God. So my name Sam actually means listen. And so when you ask me, hey, what's your name? I can just go, listen. What? Let's look at Hannah's first statement of her joy. She said, because I asked the Lord for him. You know, one of the biggest challenges in reading the Bible or reading in general is that we don't know the tone of the sentence. It's like WhatsApp. But actually, no, WhatsApp is better because WhatsApp has emoji, right? You can express your emotion that way. Too bad that the Bible doesn't offer us emoji. I wish there is. So here the tone of Hannah's sentence will make a huge difference. If someone said to Hannah, wow, you are so blessed to have a child, then whether she said, yeah, because I asked the Lord for him, or yes, because I asked the Lord for him, it will determine the state of mind of Hannah. Who's in control here? Who's the boss here? At a time when everyone did as he or she saw fit, these questions are worth exploring. If you want some hints from Hannah's statement, we can take it from the word ask. This word in Hebrew is this word, sal. What does this word look like? It does look like a name. The first king of Israel, Saul. In fact, the two words are closely related, and the name Saul actually means ask for. And interestingly, Saul, who was the king that the Israel asked for, are closely related to the word too. The word Saul, the first Hebrew word here, the S-A-A-L, also appear in 1 Samuel chapter 8 when the people were asking God to give them a king. Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking him for a king. But the word asking here is the same word that Hannah used when she said, because I asked the Lord for him. In this context, the word ask is more like demand, because we know the Israelites were demanding a king, not simply just asking politely. It's not necessarily a humble petition, but a demand of out of certain sense of entitlement. Well, can we be sure that this is the state of mind of Hannah? Well, I am not sure it is, but I am not sure that it is not either. It is possible, and from the choice of word, it is likely. And it's nothing against Hannah herself. Hannah is a human being after all, and all human beings have sinful nature in us. It's easy for any of us to lose sight of who is in charge, of who is calling the shot, especially at a time when everyone did as he or she saw fit. Hannah's story is not a fairy tale. It's real, flesh and blood. A person who experienced intense distress and misery and eventually got her prayer answered and felt vindicated. And for us, our feelings are not isolated from our circumstance and our experience. We are also in an era in which most of the time we can do what we want as we see fit. Just do it. It's a good characteristic of our time. So having a sense of entitlement in front of God is dangerous because it will disable our capacity to recognize and experience grace. Whenever I obtain something and I feel that it's because I asked for it or I did something to earn it, then it's easy to leave God out of the whole equation. If Hannah did feel that way, even if she recognized God as the one who listened to her prayer, God could have been downgraded as a God who have to act upon our demand to serve us. I should have a baby because the other wife has a few. I should have this because other people also have them. I should have that because it is how my life is defined. Brothers and sisters, these are dangerous prayer and dangerous attitude in front of God. We deserve nothing, but we're given everything because of God's grace. Same for Hannah, same for us. But for Hannah, the struggle continues. It's because we're not talking about giving up something trivial. We're talking about her son, the firstborn son. Hannah had vowed to give her firstborn son to God for all the days of his life. So this is not about temporary Nazarite. This is permanent. This is not an easy vow to keep. It's one thing that you promise God to give him what you don't have. It's another thing to give it to God when you have it. Someone might say that, I'm willing to give God $1 million. I'm willing to give God my house. I'm willing to give God my car. But I'm not willing to give God my shoes. Because I don't have $1 million. I don't have a house. I don't have a car, but I do have a pair of shoes. Is it natural that Hannah, being a mom, struggled with it? Would you struggle with it? I bet. It's no shame to admit the struggle. Because we are humans, we have affections, especially towards the one you give birth to. Now, Hannah will have to face her own promise. To understand that, we need to put the situation in a simple formula. The formula is that God wants a prophet, Hannah wants a son. Now, these two lines can be in cooperation or in conflict with each other. It all depends on the choice of Hannah. Hannah wants a son to get rid of her shame, and God gave it to her. Now, God wants a prophet to initiate this new era of kingdom. Would Hannah give it back to God? Let's see what the scripture says. When the man Elkanah went up with all his family to offer the annual sacrifice to the Lord and to fulfill his vow, Hannah did not go. She said to her husband, after the boy is weaned, I will take him and present him before the Lord, and he will live there always. Do what seems best to you, Elkanah's, her husband told her. Now, it is very interesting to see Hannah's husband was going to fulfill his vow. What vow is that? Obviously, it's reasonable to believe that Elkanah took Hannah's vow as his own. He endorsed it. He did not veto it. And now it's time to fulfill it. But Hannah said no. She did not go. It's very interesting that Hannah's first reaction, at least how the Bible recorded it, that Hannah's first reaction in fulfilling the vow was a no. Well, you can say that it's not an absolute no. It's more like a not yet, right? But we all know very well that it might be a delaying tactic, like paying tax, right? It's best not to pay, but if you have to pay, it's better to pay later than now. Some kind of procrastination here. She says she needed to wait until the boy is weaned. But honestly, there's always something to wait for, isn't it? Maybe after he finished elementary school. Maybe after he graduated from college. Maybe after he's married. Yeah, maybe after he's retired. You know, this tug of war with God is always there. Who's in control? Who's the boss? And more interesting is Elkanah's response. She told Hannah, do what seems best to you. Although the translation is different, this is essentially the line at the end of the book of Judges. Everyone did as he or she saw fit. Do how you see fit. That's the norm in the culture. By doing more diligent Bible study, we can see there are undercurrents that Hannah was struggling with God. God wants a prophet. Hannah wants a son. Are these lines going the same direction, or they are opposing one another? For parents today, God gives you a child or a few children. What about what God wants? Who's in charge here? What does God want of him or her? Or you don't care. You have the plan for your child all laid out, right? He's going to be successful. She's going to achieve a lot. At the end, are you raising your children however as you see fit? Or are you seeking a higher calling that God has for your children? Now, some of you who like or admire the Hannah in the Bible probably are mad at me that I seem to be putting a negative image on her. Now, I have nothing against Hannah personally, and I have no motive to defame her. In fact, the more we see her as a human, as a mom, like any of the mom here, who has struggled, who would get into a wrestling with God about her child, then the more we would appreciate the final decision that she had in fulfilling her vow to God. She's admirable, not because she fulfilled her promise without struggle, but because she fulfilled her promise in spite of all the struggles. That's what happened in the end of Hannah's story. We don't know what happened in between verse 23 and 24 in chapter 1, except that baby Samuel was finally weaned. At that point, Hannah knew that she could and should no longer wrestle with God. God gave her a son. She gave God a prophet. Her prayer and God's will are finally in line, and God's salvation history would progress as planned. God's will be done, but as God's will being done, God also answered Hannah's prayer. In her final prayer, Hannah said this: He, God, raises the poor from the dust and lifts the needy from the ash heap. He seats them with princes and has them inherit a throne of honor. For the foundations of the earth are the Lord's. Upon them he has set the world. He will guard the feet of his saints, but the wicked will be silenced in darkness. It's not by strength that one prevails. Those who oppose the Lord will be shattered. By letting go, Hannah's life becomes totally in sync with God's story. God is in control. And only by recognizing God's sovereignty and submitting ourselves to God, we can then be totally free to experience the grace and mercy from this loving God. God wants a prophet, Hannah wants a son. When these two lines become in sync, it forms the perfect introduction of the kingdom era. However, in a bigger picture, the formula is different. In the bigger salvation history picture, is that it's not that we need a son, it's that we need a savior. But God gave us his son. Remember, even God wants Samuel to be his prophet. He's not a God who only takes from us. Rather, when we have nothing to give him, He gave us his son to save us. So, brothers and sisters, today is not just Mother's Day, but also the day we remember Jesus' salvation through communion. As we approach the communion table, may we all seek to live our lives that are in sync with God's story, God's will, that Jesus is our Lord and we'll follow him wherever he leads us. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you for your unceasing love. At times, we might foolishly wrestle with you for control, but you always treat us with grace and mercy that we would never deserve. Today, we pray for all the mothers that they will see motherhood as a way to be your good stewards, that our goals will be in line with your kingdom goal. And now, as we approach the communion table, may you continue to guide us to be your channel of love and blessings. For we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So I'd like to ask if any of you who intend to partake with the Lord's Supper and who might not have received the cup and the bread, so anyone, just raise your hand. No? Everybody got it? Okay, good. Now I'd like to invite all of you who have confessed your faith in Jesus, who also have received baptism, that you will join me today in breaking the bread and taking the cup in remembrance of what Jesus has sacrificed for us. And now, let's take the bread out together. Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So brothers and sisters, let's take the bread now in remembrance of Jesus. Now let us unseal the cup. Get ready. In the same way, after supper, he took cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Brothers and sisters, let's take the cup now in remembrance of how Jesus saved us by dying on the cross. Thanks be to God. So, let's pray together again. Heavenly Father, we give thanks to you, for as we were sinners, you gave us your Son, that he would become one of us, died on the cross, and then raised from the dead to redeem us, to grant us mercy and grace. And now, as people who are saved, may we also bear the image of our Savior, that we will live our days following him and glorifying you. Thank you, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
we go on. There's some feedback. That tends to. Okay. Why don't we get the Lewis to introduce themselves?
Hi. Hi, VCBC. Can you hear me? Is it okay? Is there any feedback? Are we good? Yeah. Okay. Hi, VCBC. I'm Vanessa. I've been going to VCBC since 1989, and I've been there most of my life. And I'll let my husband introduce himself.
My name is Winfield. I've been going to VCBC since 2003. VCBC is the best church I've ever been to. I felt after going to VCBC for a couple of years, I grew more spiritually than I had the previous 20 years. And a big part of that is because I had all of you to walk beside me. So I feel my kids are very blessed that they can grow up in VCBC. So thank you for your support. This is Eliana, and this is Zephariah.
Hi. Day two.
So I have asked you to mute for now, so just to make things easier. So what's gonna happen is that, well, there's some delay on our end, but that's all right. So what's gonna happen is we're gonna use this chance to ask the family a few questions as a way to really get them to commit themselves. But in the same time, the dedication is also something we use for our church community as well. Just like when we baptize somebody, when we actually have weddings and we ask to say them their covenants and their vows as part of the participants. The goal is really to say that as a family, we're walking with them, we're holding them accountable, and we're trying to walk and make sure that if they encounter any challenges, we will walk alongside and support them, we'll lift them up, and we'll walk together in good and challenging times. So I'd like to ask you two questions, Winfield and Vanessa, as we commit Zephariah to God. So will you guys, as parents, continue to uphold the teachings of God and be a role model to both Zephariah and Aliana in the journey as a family, and to really uphold the values and teachings of God in your household and those you encounter? You can just give a thumbs up if you say you're, yep, okay, that's good. And together, will you also commit to raise Zephariah as he continues on to grow and develop himself to be a disciple of Jesus, and in good and challenging times to continue to extend love, compassion, and grace to him? Yep. All right. So now I have a question for the community that are joining us both online and in person here at VCBC right now. So as a community, are you willing to continue to hold the Lewis accountable, and especially for Zephariah in his walk of faith, that you'll continue to treat him as a brother in Christ, as part of us, to help him grow and develop and journey into the walk to become a disciple of Jesus? Oh, let me change this around. They can see you. All right. There's a lot of thumbs up just letting you guys know. Yeah. So with that said, why don't we enter into a word of prayer together as we pray for this family and others? There are actually 9 other children that are being dedicated in the Cantonese service later on as well. So why don't we pray for all of them as we dedicate them before God? Father God, we're just so thankful the opportunity to enter into worship, but equally importantly, we're thankful for you constantly walking and journeying with Winfield, with Vanessa, with Aliana, and also Sephariah. Thank you for raising their family to be a family after your hearts. And as they continue on, we know that dedication is just the beginning of a journey, that there's still a lot of ways as Sephariah grows up, as he encounters God, as he learns, as he walks, as he stumbles, and as he experiences that throughout this journey. May you empower Winfield and Vanessa so that they can continue to extend your character and help their children bear fruits. And as they continue on too, may we as a family, even though maybe during COVID, we're not as able to be engaging in person, that way, may we support them. May we extend care to them in times of need. May we send encouragement to them in times of challenges and in their small and big victories as well. May we also be able to share joy with them. We give thanks for this opportunity. And as we dedicate Sephariah to you, may you delight in this child of God. We give thanks for everything, and we pray all these in your son's precious name. Amen. Awesome. So with that, I introduce to you the Liu family with our dedicated children, Aliana, who has done that a couple of years back, and now Sephariah as well. Why don't we give a hand to welcome them? All right, thank you for joining us, Liu. As we continue to worship, you can join us on YouTube live stream as well. So as you saw earlier, we have a chance to celebrate time of family and as you know, we are in this series together, called with one another on Sundays, trying to figure out what it means to live a life back as a family, a spiritual family of God. And so speaking of family, I wonder, what do we have today, or what do we have upcoming as a family? And I see that Willis is coming up. So I wonder what we're going to do as a family.
Hello, Pastor Brian.
Hello.
How are you doing?
Hello. So how come I see that you have some chairs here. So
chair.
What's going on?
We're preparing for a picnic. Do you know that a picnic's coming up?
Picnic? Really? What kind of picnic is this?
Well, it's not just for the two of us, but this is just we've got to test out these chairs.
Yeah.
We're having a picnic on Saturday, June 4th for the whole congregation, and you're all invited. So not just you, but everyone else.
Yeah, not just me, right? Like everyone, even those who are online, right?
Yeah, even those people who have not been able to join us. So it's happening on Saturday, June 4th at Trout Lake at 11 o'clock.
So what if I can't show up at 11 sharp? Like, how is that going to work?
Well, you can show up anytime after 11. We'll be there till 3 o'clock. So hoping to see as many people as we can show up at Trout Lake. Bring your own chairs, blankets, games. I brought my spike ball game.
Oh yeah, you're so prepared.
Yeah, I'm super prepared.
So, do I have to bring any food, or what's gonna happen?
So, please bring your own main course, and we will be providing some light snacks and drinks. And there is a link in the well to sign up. You don't have to, but it gives us a chance to know how much drinks and snacks to prepare.
So why is this important then? Why do we have this picnic together?
Well, over the past couple of years, it's been hard to get together in a large group. So in an outdoor setting, we're hoping that more people can come out and just connect and reconnect. Really looking forward to this time when we can have a family reunion picnic. And this family, is really talking about our whole church family. So looking forward to it.
That's great. Thank you so much, Willis.
Yep,
so
no problem.
I guess I'll see you there at Trout Lake. Rain or shine, right?
Rain or shine.
All right, sounds
That's
great.
Right.
Thank you. So before the worship team comes up and lead us into a song of proclamation, why don't we use this time also to lift our hands and pray for all the other things and the challenges and the victories that we want to celebrate and pray for as a community together. Father God, we're just so thankful for this opportunity to have a chance to experience creation. And we're so thankful as well for this community garden project that we have started. As we continue on, may you challenge us to be mindful of creation care. And also for those brothers and sisters who are involved in this, that you will help us experience you and help them bond over this project. We also want to pray for those who are in illness in our community as well. We pray for those who are about to engage in surgeries, those who are recovering from various treatments and surgeries, those who are under ailments or sick, Lord, that you continue to extend your healing hand to them. And for those who are barred from being able to enter into a fellowship in person with us, Lord, for whatever reason, we pray that through various engagements, and especially in coming into the summertime, that we're able to be more proactive in sharing love with one another in the community. And we pray that you will guide us to have that compassion to love those around us. And as Pastor Sam shared earlier today too, that as we are experiencing this story of Hannah's prayer, Lord God, may we be not just pulling away from God for what we thought we are expecting and wanting in our lives, but to really be in partnership with God, whether we are mothers, fathers, grandparents, brothers, sisters, or even cousins and friends, that we'll be able to listen to you, to be attentive to you, so we're in this partnership to reach the world around us. So as we continue on to worship, Lord, may you be glorified, and may you be the Lord over our lives. We give thanks, and we pray all these in your Son's precious name. Amen.
I invite you all to stand now as we end off our service with a song of proclamation. And what is it that we are proclaiming? Well, we're proclaiming that God is faithful in everything, and that even in our own waiting, whatever we're waiting for, he is still the one who provides. And we proclaim that, yes, we will praise him even in our lowest points, and whether it's in our lowest points or in our highest points. So let's sing. God who never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Oh, yes, I will. God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now.
God who's never late is working all things out. You're working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. For nothing can stand against. And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names. Nothing can stand against. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will.
So now as we leave this place, just go with the fullness of God in your hearts, knowing that He will provide, He is faithful, and that He never fails. So go in peace, and we hope to see you next time, and have a great week. Bye now.